Good morning, McCoy. How are you today? Doing well. Looks like we must be a holiday weekend. We got a little bit of a smaller attendance today, but that's okay. Beautiful sunny day, and looking forward to a great time of worship together, whether you're here in the sanctuary, in the AMPR, or online with us today. We've come to worship our Lord, and we have so many ways from Scripture that we are encouraged to worship. One of the ones that we see often in the Psalms, though, is God is the psalmist calling on God to help him, to pull him through, to take him through whatever he's facing that day. And that is part of the attitude we want to come today as we start with our opening hymn, O God, our help in ages past. God is the same yesterday, today, forever, and we can call on him and go to him, and that's what we want to make part of our worship today as we come admitting, Lord, we need you today. We need you. So would you please stand and let's worship together.
Oh, God, our help in ages past, our hope for years to come, our shelter from the stormy blast, and our eternal home. Under the shadow of thy throne, thy saints have dwelt
Let's look to the Lord in prayer. Our Father, we are thankful that we live in a country that has a special day reserved called Memorial Day. And we are thankful for the countless men and women over the history of our country, even through right till today, that have served us in the sense of going to war, of being in the military. We think of police and firefighters. We think of those that put their lives in harm's way, and sometimes they make the ultimate sacrifice for us and for our freedoms. And we remember all of these folks, and we ought to be people of deep appreciation for what has taken place in the history of our country. Help us, our Father, to be patriots and to be loyal to our country, to fight for what is true and right and just, and to uphold our Constitution of these United States, no matter what it costs us. And I pray that what others have done for us, we would do for our children and grandchildren. Help us to be people of principle and give us grace to be brave and have courageous, to be courageous with your help and by your grace. Now today we've gathered to worship as a church. We pray for those who are traveling and away, and we ask for safety for them. Thank you that they can be away with their families and special occasions, but we're thankful that we can be here. We pray that you do mighty things in our midst. Help us all to be engaged in this service and to be a part of it, whatever that may look like this morning. And may we hear your voice through your word this morning, I pray in Jesus' name, amen. There are several announcements I need to make. Christopher had to be called out here downstairs. They were having a little bit of problem with the live stream, I think. So I'm making these announcements. First of all, want to say that Vacation Bible School is coming, and we need to have you invite others to get them to register. The information is in your bulletin, and let's get registered for Vacation Bible School. It starts, I believe, in 2 weeks. I think I'm right on that, or close to it. Yeah, looking forward to it. And not only that, but next Sunday, we have our connection groups, connections. And they start next Sunday, and there'll be 6 times throughout the summer, June, July, and August. We've got those dates all laid out, and the first one is next Sunday. So let's make that a priority. Be there if we signed up. By the way, we have a lot of people involved in this throughout the summer. This is kind of exciting, and we'd like to continue it into future time, too, but we're going to be evaluating that. But there are still a few places, like 3 or 4, that are open. If you are still interested in being a part, you need to see Pastor Christopher, all right? And he'll get you plugged into those places. All right, we have our daily breads for June, July, and August, so they're back there on the table. Make sure you pick one up if you would like that. We're also involved in getting food, filling the pantry of Oscar and Jenny. They're coming from Mexico for 2 months as a brief home assignment. They're coming June 9th, and they're living in our green 137 Foster Avenue home. And so we want to put things in the pantry, and the list is here in the bulletin of what you need to do. You know, it says we would like to collect food, pantry items, gift cards for them. If you could help, please see a list of items on the bulletin board of what to purchase and sign up for. Bring the stuff here. We have one more Sunday. There's a table set up in the far foyer for you to put those things. These are non-perishable items. And then one more thing, and that is this coming Wednesday night, we start our summer, I almost said fall. Our summer schedule is on. I didn't get to it. So it's summer schedule. And on Wednesday nights, we're going to be moving. We're going to be having a midweek, great in the midweek, rather than waiting till next Sunday. We have an opportunity. We'll be studying the Word of God. We'll be in the Minor Prophets, beginning with Hosea. This coming Wednesday night, it will be a full study of God's word. Following that, we will have a time of prayer in smaller groups. And I just want to say this, if for whatever reason, you cannot stay for the prayer time in smaller groups, I encourage you to come for the study in the Word of God. Okay? So this is kind of like my fall class, only done in the summer, beginning on this coming Wednesday. But we are going to have prayer time following it. All right. That is all I have.
Stand and worship as you're able with us as we continue to focus on our Lord. From Psalm 138, I will praise you, Lord, with all my heart. Before the gods, I will sing your praise. I will bow down towards your holy temple and will praise your name for your unfailing love and your faithfulness. For you have so exalted your solemn decree that it surpasses your fame. From the ends of the earth, your name we praise from the hearts of the
shouts of the strong. From the lips of all people, this song we raise.
Answer me. You greatly embolden me.
May all the kings of the earth praise you, Lord, when they hear what you have decreed. May they sing of the ways of the Lord, for the glory of the Lord is great.
Thank you.
Though the Lord is exalted, he looks kindly on the lowly. Though lofty, he sees them from afar.
Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you preserve my life. You stretch out your hand against the anger of my foes. With your right hand, you save me. The Lord will vindicate me. Your love, Lord, endures forever. Do not abandon the works of your hands.
Thank you that as we call on you and praise your name, and Lord, recognize that without you we can do nothing, that we need you every moment, every day, and that you've given us your power working in us today, that same power that raised Christ from the dead, you have given us through your Holy Spirit. And so easily we forget that, and we think we've got to do things on our own, or even we forget that we can be bold because of what you have done. And I pray today you would help us today and each day to apply your word and to live in that power. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Man, oh man, that was powerful. Amen. It really was. Great songs, and everyone was singing so well. We just had a sermon and song, but don't think you're going to get out of this one. No, that was powerful. Powerful words, and you all sang so well. Well, I would invite you to open your Bible with me to Daniel chapter 8. Next Sunday, we move on to Daniel chapter 9. So we're going to move beyond Daniel 8. But you know, I came across, as you're turning there and kind of getting things ready, I came across a very interesting fact this morning. And I checked it out. But it's about Sir Isaac Newton. We've all heard about him, right? He lived from 1642 to 1727. And you know his legacy. He invented the reflecting telescope. Okay? The standard telescope of his time was the refracting telescope. And that was not the most ideal, so he invented the reflecting telescope. He proposed a new theory of light and color, worked and created things with regard to optics that we still use today. He discovered calculus. For that, we forgive him. Caleb, which calculus are you in? The third calculus. Oh. Okay, bless you, my son, you know. He discovered calculus and developed that. He developed three laws of motion. He devised the law of universal gravitation. Remember the apple thing? And he advanced early modern chemistry. Do you know that Sir Isaac Newton was a believer? He loved the Lord Jesus. And he loved the Word of God. And he wrote on the Bible. He studied it. He was a student of the Bible. And one of his publications, actually it was published after his death in 1733, but one of his publications was called Observations Upon the Prophecies of Daniel and the Apocalypse of St. John, the book of Revelation. So he had a book, Observations, that he made on the book of Daniel and the Apocalypse of St. John. And in his book, Sir Isaac Newton, in 1733, when, you know, folks, let me just tell you, in that year, you know, biblical prophecy, prophecy conferences, books about prophecy, things like that about the end times were not in vogue and were not written. But Sir Isaac Newton, the guy was sharp. He made this statement. He said in this book, at about the time of the end, there would be a body of men who would turn their attention to the prophecies of the Word of God. And they would insist upon their literal interpretation in the midst of much clamor and resistance. We are right there. We have been for about 100 years. When all of a sudden these great books, the prophets, the book of Daniel, the book of Revelation, have been studied, commentaries have been written. And I believe it's because this is the time in history when we are approaching, if not right at the door, of these tremendous climatic events that are going to occur before the second return of Jesus Christ and his millennial kingdom on this earth to follow. But before that time's going to come, there's going to be great tribulation on this earth. And we are moving. Sir Isaac Newton is right. Even though in his day they were not doing this, today we are. And today this has all been opened up through faithful men and women of God who study using the literal, grammatical, contextual, historical method of interpretation and treating God's word with respect. God wrote it. He wrote it to be understood, and we need to understand it from the beginning to the end. So I think that's so powerful. Now, as we come to Daniel chapter 8, this chapter, Daniel's second vision, okay? Folks, it has a level of complexity to it. Now, I'm going to ask you to do two things. I'm going to ask you to meet me in the middle this morning, okay? You say, what do you mean, meet me in the middle? I mean, I have tried to work hard to make the complex simple. But it's still complex. And so that's my part as I come to this pulpit to open the Word of God. That's my part that I've spent this week a considerable number of hours in order to be able to present God's Word to my people. But the second thing is I'm asking you to join me with me in the message today, to engage, to get engaged, because you'll need to put your thinking caps on and give your focused attention to the study of God's Word and seek to understand. So I know it's a Sunday morning. I know it's Memorial Day weekend. I know there's lots of plans going on, and that's good, but I'm asking you to get engaged here, and we'll try to do our best. Now, there are four major headings that I want to cover. Some of them I'm going to move through really quick because they're kind of review, but I'm putting all this together. So the first major heading that I want us to look at and remember is the reception of Daniel's vision. That's verses 1 and 2. Look at it. In the third year of King Belshazzar's reign, I, Daniel, had a vision after the one that had already appeared to me. That's chapter 7, 2 years prior to this. Okay, here's another one. In my vision, I saw myself in the citadel of Susa in the province of Elam. In the vision, I was beside the Ulai Canal. So, first of all, very quickly, the position of the vision. We know the year was 551 BC, 2 years after the one of chapter 7, and 12 years before the fall of the Babylonian Empire, 12 years before the event of Daniel chapter 5. The second thing, the profile of the vision. And the visions, and I'm going to put a chart up here. I hope this is helpful to you. I put these things up here to be helpful, to make the complex simple. Notice the name of this chart. It is the correlation of dreams and visions in chapter 2, chapter 7, and chapter 8. So, the visions in Daniel 2 and 7, those are the ones furthest to the left, summarize the rise and the fall of four kingdoms: Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, and Rome. Both Rome in its initial strong phase and its future weaker phase. Now, the vision of chapter 8 that we're in right now, Daniel's second vision, this vision zeroes in on the second and third of those kingdoms. That's important to see. That's the focus, Medo-Persia
and Greece. I've got them circled up there, right in the middle. This is the focus of Daniel chapter 8. And there's a reason why, and we'll get to that. These two kingdoms are singled out because they have special relevance for the Jewish people. Now, let me share with you a comment by Dr. David Jeremiah that I found helpful, really helpful, and I think you will too. Dr. Jeremiah said this, in this vision, chapter 8, we get a glimpse of a terrible part of the world's, terrible part of the world's future, a glimpse by understanding a terrible part of the Jews' past. That is a great comment. I want to read, in this vision, we get a glimpse of a terrible part of the world's future, which I think we're on the very threshold of. By understanding a terrible part of the Jews' past. Even though the Jews suffered horrifically under a Greek ruler, and that's what we're going to be looking at today, it cannot compare to the suffering under the coming Antichrist. That's a great summary of what this chapter is about. Here's another one by Dr. Dwight Pentecost. The key to understanding chapters 7 through 12, and those chapters cover four visions that God gave directly to Daniel. We're now in the second one, chapter 8. But the key to understanding chapters 7 through 12 of Daniel's prophecy is to understand that Daniel is focusing his attention on this one great ruler and his kingdom, the Antichrist. And his kingdom, his a nation confederacy that will rise, a revived form, a future weaker form of the Roman Empire, though it may not be called that. Daniel is focusing his attention on this one great ruler in his kingdom, which will arise in the end time. And while Daniel may use historical reference and refer to events which to us may be fulfilled already, Daniel is thinking of them only to give us more details about this final form of Gentile world power and its ruler who will reign on the earth. All four of Daniel's visions focus on that. That is the point. Now, the other thing, just as we move through this, the place of this vision. It took place, Daniel was actually in Babylon, but was transported in a vision to Susa, a town little known at that time, 551 BC, little known and unsuspected for its future grandeur, long before the Persian Empire began and came to power. Before Babylon fell, Daniel saw himself at the capital of the future Persian kingdom. The second heading I want us to look at here is the revelation of Daniel's vision. In other words, this is verse, notice in your Bibles, this is verse 3 to 14. 3 to 14. This Daniel tells us what he actually saw in the vision. The interpretation is coming. But he tells us what he actually saw. And two animals dominate Daniel's vision. A ram and a goat. These two animals picture a fierce battle between two headstrong rulers and their kingdoms that are engaged in their struggle for dominance in the world. Medo-Persia, followed by Greece. And we don't have to guess. You say, well, that's your interpretation. No, God tells us right here. The angel Gabriel tells us who the ram is and who the goat. Okay, so let's look at these. Because I'm just moving through this quickly for context. First of all, the ram, verses 3 and 4. And that ram, this ram is identified for. Who is this ram? It's the kingdom that followed, the empire that followed Babylon. Look at verse 20. The two-horned ram that you saw represents the kings of Media and Persia. Period. We don't have to guess at it. Then, after the Medo-Persian Empire ran its course over a couple of centuries, the goat came. And we don't have to guess as to what the goat is all about, because Daniel saw this goat coming from the west at great speed. Its feet didn't even touch the ground. It was so fast. And the goat is identified in verse 21. Look at verse 21. The shaggy goat is the king of Greece. And the large horn between his eyes is the first king. So, we know that the Greek Empire coming from the west, from Philip of Macedonia, Greece. Philip of Macedon was the father of Alexander the Great. And he said, son, you're much smarter. You've got so much more ability than I do. The world is yours to conquer. And he said, I'm going to do it. Starting from the west and moving to the east all the way to India, in 12 years, Alexander the Great conquered the world, the known world at that time, as far as civilization and so forth. Conquered the known world. He took it over. So that's what, Medo-Persia fell to the Greeks in 331 BC. Well, I want us to draw our attention to something. First of all, we need to take a look. I've already kind of gotten ahead of myself at the prominent horn. And he's identified in verse 21. This is the Greek Empire's first king, and that's Alexander the Great. Alexander the Great. As soon, I already said that he came with great speed, with a great army, and in 12 years. He was, when he conquered from Greece to India, he did it in 12 years. And when he got way over there and conquered it all, he was 33 years old. 33 years old. And it says he wept because there was no more to conquer. He died. Many historians think he was poisoned. His armies were so worn out, so tired of battle and conquering, that they had to get rid of this guy. Well, that's the prominent horn in this goat. But after Alexander died, as soon as the goat with the prominent horn between his eyes became powerful, the large horn between his eyes was broken off in this vision. Okay, you'll have to look at verse 8. Look at verse 8. It says, the goat became very great, but at the height of his power, his large horn was broken off. He died. And in its place, four prominent horns grew up toward the four winds of heaven. So we need to understand these four prominent horns that came after Alexander died. Four other prominent horns grew up. Greece had hardly reached the peak of its power when Alexander died at the age of 33 in 323 BC. When Alexander died, history tells us that four of his generals fought and fussed with each other. It took about 20 years, but finally, four of his generals divided up the vast empire and formed separate kingdoms. And here are the four generals: Ptolemy, Seleucus, Cassander, and Lysimachus. Now, Cassander and Lysimachus don't figure anymore in the Bible. Okay? You'll see why in a moment. It's Ptolemy who took Egypt, and Seleucus took Egypt, and Seleucus who took Syria. that figure in the Bible. And notice I have the Seleucus highlighted in a darker color. And there's a reason for that. Because the focus of this chapter comes from his dynasty. So here's the division of the empire of Greece. You'll notice that Seleucus took all that area, and notice that includes, this is Syria today. And Ptolemy took Egypt and North Africa and so forth and made separate kingdoms. These two don't figure in the Word of God because they don't have anything to do with the Jewish people. It's the focus of all this is about. And what is going to happen at the very end of the period of indignation, the times of the Gentiles. But you'll notice right in between Syria, or the Seleucid kingdom and the Ptolemaic kingdom, Egypt, between those is Jerusalem. Just like today. Well, one more thing that we need to understand, and that is this. Look what happened in verse 9. And I'm going to read verse 9 through 14, because this is the central point of this whole vision. In fact, do you know that in chapter 8, follow me now, in chapter 8, verse 1, it says Daniel had a vision. Do you know that this vision has a name? I mean, more than just a vision. It has a specific name, what it's all about. Look at verse 26 at the end. The vision of the evenings and mornings has been given you, that has been given to you, is true. So the name of this vision of chapter 8 is the vision of the evenings and mornings. And we're about to find out what that's all about. Look at verse 9. Out of one of them, that is one of the four horns that grew up, out of one of them, another horn, which started small, but grew in power to the south and to the east and toward the beautiful land. It grew until it reached the host of the heavens, and it threw some of the starry host down to the earth and trampled on them. It set itself up to be as great as the prince of the host. It took away the daily sacrifice from him, and the place of his sanctuary was brought low. Because of rebellion, the host of the saints and the daily sacrifice were given over to it. That is the small horn. It prospered in everything it did, and truth was thrown to the ground. Then I heard a holy one speaking, and another holy one said to him, How long will it take for the vision to be fulfilled? The vision concerning the daily sacrifice, the rebellion that causes desolation, and the surrender of the sanctuary and of the host that will be trampled underfoot. How long? He said to me, it will take 2,300 evenings and mornings, then the sanctuary will be reconsecrated. This vision has a title. It is the vision of the evenings and mornings. It is focused on what will take place during those 6 years and 110 days, 2,300 evenings and mornings, 2,300 days. What is going to take place in the beautiful land by this small horn? And what is going to take place will be a foreshadowing of what is going to take place in the end time. That's what this is about. That's what God is revealing to Daniel. So the one small horn, although it was small at first, it grew to great influence toward the southeast beautiful land. This indicated that a significant king would come to power from one of the four divisions of the Greek Empire. This king was named Antiochus IV. And here's, I know this is smaller, but here's Alexander the Great and his years, the time of his death. 20 years afterward, his generals divided up his kingdom, but two of them don't matter as far as Israel is concerned, but two of them do. And that is Ptolemy, Egypt, and Syria, the Seleucids, right on down. When it's predominantly yellow over here, notice how it extends out. That's when the Egyptians, under the Ptolemaic dynasty, that's when they were in power over the beautiful land, over Jerusalem, the people of Israel. That's when the Jews were under their, what am I trying to say? Thumb. Yeah, that's what this is. Okay. And then over here, this is when the Syrians became dominant over the beautiful land, over the temple, over Jerusalem. And here's our man, the eighth, right here. His name is Antiochus the Fourth, and he gave himself the name Epiphanes because it means God manifest on the earth. He reigned from 175 to 164, and right in that time is when the 6 years and 110 days occur. It's when he turned his attention toward the beautiful land and toward the Jewish temple and what he did to it. He was a monster. He was a Hitler-type anti-Semite. He hated the Jewish religion and the Jews and did despicable and unspeakable things to them during this time. So this king was Antiochus IV. He was the eighth ruler of the Seleucid or Syrian division that came out of the Greek Empire. He moved south, he moved against Egypt, and then he moved toward the beautiful land in 171 BC. So 171 to 165 is 6 years. And you'll see why we end at 165 in just a bit. Okay. Let me say something about this guy. Let me give you a little bit more things to think about. We learn a lot about him from the apocryphal book of 1 Maccabees. The apocryphal book of 1 Maccabees gives us excruciating detail of how Antiochus persecuted and murdered tens of thousands of Jews and desecrated the temple in Jerusalem. He was determined to wipe the Jewish religion off of the earth forever and replace it with Greek worship and Greek culture. Antiochus forbade the practice of Judaism and he forced the practice of pagan religion. He committed unspeakable and horrific acts of torture and brutality against the Jews. Antiochus desecrated the temple in Jerusalem by sacrificing a pig on the altar and throwing its blood all around the interior. What Daniel and Jesus referred to as the abomination of desolation. The abomination that causes desolation. The Antichrist is going to do something similar in the great tribulation to come when he enthrones an image of himself in the temple and causes all in the world to worship him. Epiphanes, God manifest. In Daniel's vision, he was told that Antiochus's reign of terror and desecration is going to last 2,300 days, after which the sanctuary is going to be cleansed and reconsecrated and rededicated to the Lord. The temple was indeed restored and cleansed under the Jewish leader, Judas Maccabeus, on December the 25th, 165 BC. The resistance to Antiochus began in the village of Modin, where a priest named Mattathias led an attack on a group of Antiochus's soldiers. Mattathias and his five sons fled. They became known as the Maccabees, a name related to the Aramaic word for a hammer, because of their ferocity of their defense of Judaism against Antiochus. Led by the Maccabees, the Jews recaptured and restored the temple on December the 25th, 165 BC, And that would place the starting point of the 2,300 days from that date back, or from that date back, would take us to the September the 6th of 171 BC. That's what this vision is all about. It's the vision of the evenings and mornings. That's what it's all about right there. Now, let's come now to my third heading, and that third heading is interpretation. Beginning in verse 15, down through verse 25, we have the interpretation given by the angel Gabriel. It says in verse 15, "While I, Daniel, was watching the vision and trying to understand it, there before me stood one who looked like a man. And I heard a man's voice from the Ulai calling, 'Gabriel, tell this man the meaning of the vision.'" So this powerful angel that appears other places in the Bible, another time in Daniel 9, we'll see him, and in Luke chapter 1, tells Daniel what this is all about. So he is what I call the perceiver of the vision. And that's Gabriel who explained it. The other thing that's really important here is notice the purpose of the vision. The purpose of the vision. The words of Gabriel are very reassuring to Daniel. And for the very first time in this chapter, his words indicate that the time of the end is the focus in relation to the vision. That's when this vision is really pointing to the time of the end. Everyone with me? Until the time of the end, right. Verse 19 even elaborates more. He said, "I am going to tell you what will happen later in the time of wrath, because the vision concerns the appointed time of the end," like all of these do, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12. It's all about that. And then one last thing. Notice verse 26. "The vision of the evenings and mornings that has been given is true, but seal it up, for it concerns the distant future." The distant future. Now, what is this time of the end, or this later in the time of wrath? Or the ESV says, "at the latter end of the indignation, at the final period of the indignation, the latter time." What is the indignation? I touched on this last week, but I want you to see it. The indignation has to do with the people of Israel, God's attitude toward them, ever since he sent the Assyrian Empire in the 700, 722, 734, he sent the Assyrian Empire, who finally destroyed the northern kingdom of Israel in 722. God did that. The indignation refers to the period of history during which God is indignant. He's angry with Israel because of its rebellion against him and against the Mosaic covenant. It is the time when God chastens Israel, usually at the hands of the Gentiles. So this is the indignation is God's program for Israel. It started when Assyria conquered the 10 northern tribes, and it will continue until the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Forget Isaiah. This is the only chart I have, but this is the division of the United Kingdom under Saul, David, and Solomon. 10 tribes became its own kingdom, and they had 20 kings, and they were all godless idolaters. Finally, God brought the Assyrian Empire and utterly obliterated the northern kingdom. That's the beginning of God's program for the Jews, until they repent at the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's the time of indignation. And it parallels somewhat the times of the Gentiles. But the southern kingdom, they had a few godly kings, and they came all the way down here to 586 when the Babylonians came and utterly destroyed Jerusalem, tore the temple down, and so forth. But I'm trying to say to you that this is what this is talking about, the indignation. Now, in 6, when the Babylonian Empire was sent against the southern kingdom, what is in the southern kingdom that's really important? Jerusalem and the Temple Mount, right? The Temple of Solomon. So, during the times of the Gentiles, Jerusalem is the focus. Jesus said, Jerusalem will be trampled on by the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled. And they are not to this day. Once again, the time of indignation and the time, the program for the Gentiles, and that they will be permitted by God to trample on Jerusalem until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled. And that will happen when the Antichrist and his empire is organized and when he captivates the world. And the world follows his program. In fact, Jesus said this time is going to be so in the middle of the week for the next 3.5 years, in the final period of Daniel's 70th week, which we're going to be getting into. It's going to be so horrific on the earth, both toward the inhabitants of the earth, as God's wrath is poured out finally, the day of the Lord, on this earth and its inhabitants, as well as on his people, the Jewish people, in preparation for the coming of the Lord. But Jesus said, these days are going to be so bad that there's never been a time in human history like it, and there will be again, and unless the days are limited, 1,260 days, 3.5 years, 42 months, unless the days are limited, no flesh on the earth will survive. So that's the purpose of this. The 2,300 evenings and mornings. That's what this is all about. The person of the vision, the futuristic emphasis that I've just laid out for you in this interpretation that has to do with leads many conservative evangelical theologians and expositors of the Word of God to this conclusion. To conclude that this difficult passage goes beyond that which is historically fulfilled in Antiochus Epiphanes, to foreshadow a future personage, often identified as the world ruler of the end time, known as the beast or the Antichrist. What you see going to happen during those 2,300 evenings and mornings, the eighth king of the Seleucid that's coming. And that was 380 years after Daniel. Is going to be a microcosm. Is going to be just a taste of what is coming in the time of the end, which it points toward. Antiochus Epiphanes, in the way he treated the Jews during those 2,300 days, becomes a type of the Antichrist to come during the Great Tribulation at the end of the age. Daniel's prophecies concerning Antiochus have already been fulfilled. That's history. But their anti-typical fulfillment in the Antichrist are yet to come. And the parallels between these two are so striking that Antiochus is sometimes referred to as the Antichrist of the Old Testament. Listen to these. Listen to the characteristics of these two, the Antiochus the Fourth and the Antichrist. They parallel one another. Both begin modestly, but increase in power and influence. They begin small. Both blaspheme God with mouths that speak boastful things. Both persecute the Jewish temple and desecrate it. Both claim to be gods and put images in the temple. Both impose their own religion on the people. Both are opposed by a believing remnant that knows God. And you say, well, what's that in the book of Revelation? The 144,000, as well as the two witnesses, as well as other believers during that time. Both appear to succeed marvelously and seem to be invincible, and both are finally defeated by the coming of a Redeemer. In past history, that was Judas Maccabeus for the Jews at that time. At the time of the end, it's Jesus Christ in his return. Now, one last heading, and that is this. Whoa, before we get to it, I want to bring up Dr. Jeremiah's quote again. In this vision, we get a glimpse of a terrible part of the world's future by understanding a terrible part of the Jews' past. Even though the Jews suffered horrifically under a Greek ruler, it cannot compare to the suffering under the coming Antichrist. So that brings us to the conclusion of the vision. Notice verse 26 and 27. This is the conclusion. The vision of the evenings and mornings, that's the title, that has been given you, Daniel, is true. But seal up the vision, for it concerns the distant future. I, Daniel, notice his response. I, Daniel, was exhausted, and I lay ill for several days. Then I got up and went about the king's business. I was appalled. I was appalled by the vision. It was beyond understanding. Our friend Daniel had this astounding visitation by the angel Gabriel, and it literally made him ill. He was told to seal up the vision. And that simply means that he should preserve the manuscript, preserve it, so that it could be communicated and studied and expounded at a later time. And I think now is the time. And has been in God's program and plan in the past decades. This is when the great truths about biblical prophecy have been the focus of the church. And there's a reason for that. Daniel followed the instructions and has given it and to us, to all generations of Bible-believing Christians. I'm so thankful he did. However, when he saw his people under the persecution of these tyrants, and realized that many of them would be slaughtered, it grieved him immensely. It appalled him. He was ill. He fainted. He became ill. He became emotional. No wonder Daniel was exhausted and lay ill for several days once he understood the totality of what he had seen. You know, I think we need to respond the same way, folks. I do. We're too comfortable. We're rich. We're increased with goods. We should respond the same way, not necessarily with being sick, but with a sober realization of what lies ahead in the future, and I think in the very near future. And we should do everything we can to help those who do not know Christ today escape what is coming in the future, both on this earth during the Great Tribulation, but beyond this earth into eternity. And here's the good news, and you know what it is. Here's the good news. The good news is that God has provided a way of escape. Amen? Amen. It's the only way. There is one way of escape. The Apostle Paul wrote about it in 2 Corinthians. And notice what he said. What powerful verses these are. How challenging they are. God was reconciling the world to himself. Sin has put a wedge between the Creator and his creation, humanity. We have rebelled against God, and he is angry, his wrath toward us. But God has initiated reconciliation. Aren't you glad for that? Amen. He's initiated it. God was reconciling the world to himself. How? In Christ, his Son. God so loved the world that he gave. And now he's not counting men's sins against them. Well, look at the second highlighted area down there. God made him who had no sin, that is Jesus, to be sin for us, so that in him, in Christ, we might become the righteousness of God. Amen. Amen. God took the initiative, and now, everyone in the world is in a savable position because of what Jesus did. They're in a savable position. And now we have a responsibility. Look, and he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. Can you imagine that? You know what that means? We are therefore Christ's ambassadors. Ambassadors. As though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. I like the image of the banquet. No, I've used that. The table has been set, right? You didn't have to provide anything. It's all prepared. And we have the message, come. Come. Take. Receive. It's a gift the Creator wants to give to you. And I love this last invitation. Uh-oh, it's not 2 Corinthians 5. Revelation 22:17. The Spirit and the bride say, come. And let him who hears say, come. Whoever is thirsty, let him come. And whoever wishes, let him take the free gift of the water of life. Amen. It's right toward the very end of the Bible. Because the table is set. We are Christ's ambassadors. And I'm asking myself, and I'm asking you, who have you told about the Lord Jesus Christ? May the Lord ask us, help us, I mean, to care about those whom God has placed within our realm of influence. Not only in light of the fact that we're standing at the threshold of the coming of the Lord and the events that will precede it, which are not going to be, or they're going to be tumultuous and horrific for this earth and its inhabitants, and especially and particularly for the Jews. Antiochus was bad, Haman was bad, Hitler was bad, but not like the one that's coming. And unless those days were limited, no flesh will survive. But even if that wasn't there, what about eternity? And so I just end with this simple plea. To everyone who's listening to me, whether, you know, we say all these various places, and I'm thankful for them. Do you know for absolutely sure that you're saved? That you have placed your trust, your faith, in the Lord Jesus Christ, who died for you and rose again from the dead. That is God's way, and there's one way. Have you, by faith, trusted the Lord to save you? You need to do that and take care of it. Let's pray. our most precious Heavenly Father, thank you for these things are so huge and so great. Thank you for what you've given us. I'm thankful that Daniel preserved these things. Of course, that was your plan. And we have not only the book of Daniel and this chapter, we have the whole Bible, the whole counsel that you want revealed, and how we need to be men and women of the book, not only knowing it academically, but living passionately in light of its truth. It's no time for ease and slothfulness and apathy and coldness and worldliness. It's time for recentering and refocus. And I pray that you would deal with us and with this church and churches throughout this city and our state. And may there be a great awakening, a great moving. Help us, because I don't think we know how to help ourselves. I pray that you would help us, O Lord, and send us fresh wind, fresh fire from heaven. For the sake of us, your people, for the sake of your name, for the sake of countless lost men and women and children who desperately need to know the way and be saved. We pray these things now in Jesus' most precious name. Amen.
What we need each day, and what our church needs, and what our country needs, and what this world needs, is a vision of God, of His purpose, His love, His righteousness and holiness, and His purpose to achieve in this world. So let's close with the hymn, Be Thou My Vision. I encourage you to stand and join us.
Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou my best thought, by day or by night. Waking or sleeping, thy presence by night. Be thou my wisdom, and thou my true worth. I ever with thee, and thou with me, Lord. Thou my great Father, by thy true Son. Thou in me dwelling, and I with thee one. Riches I need not, nor man's empty praise. Thou mine inheritance, now and always. Thou and thou only, first in my heart. My King of heaven, my treasure thou art. My King of heaven, my victory won. May I reach heaven's shores, all bright and sun.
Dismissed.
to hear you on the piano.